Good evening, Oxford family, and all those joining us online. Here at Oxford Baptist, we believe that a relationship with Jesus changes everything. And we hope and pray that you believe that too. For those of you who don't know me that well, my name is Cameron Van Bemmel, and I'm married to my beautiful wife, Krista, of 15 years. We have three lovely daughters together, Caitlin, Lexi, and Haley. And we have been attending Oxford since about 2006. They were supposed to be here with me today, but they're off at Camp Bimini for the week with Krista volunteering as a camp nurse. So I am batching it this week. If anyone's got any extra leftovers or fresh pies, you can find my address in the directory there. I also have been serving on the elders board for the last 2 years, and it has been an amazing opportunity to grow in my faith. I'm also thankful for the other elders who serve as well. As I get to see the heart that these men have for Jesus, we as a church family are very blessed to have an elders board who desire to put God first. All right, the announcements for the week. We have quite a few here, so hopefully I don't put you to sleep. This past week, we had our first day camp called I Wonder. It was a great week of discovering who God is through his creation. Almost half of the kids who attended were from outside the church community, and it was a great way for them to experience God's love. Please pray for these kids that they would continue to see God at work in their lives and come to know Jesus as their Savior. This coming week is our VBS Zoomerang. Please also pray for the 60 kids who are registered to attend and for all the leaders that will be ministering to them. All right, kids, this one's for you. If you're interested in attending our exciting day camp the week of August 8th called On the Case, then there is still time to sign up. Kids will dig in and search for clues into some of Jesus's parables. All the information can be found on the website at oxfordbaptist.ca. This Wednesday, the youth continue to meet for their weekly summer campfire. Anyone heading into grade 6 through grade 12 can attend, and they're welcome to come out. We ask that guys bring a snack and the girls bring drinks to share. And then don't forget to bring your Bible and something to sit on. This Wednesday's campfire will be at the Brittenell's house. The address and any other information can be found at oxfordbaptist.ca. For all the senior high out there, this is the last day to sign up for Prepare 22. It's a camping trip from August 29th to September 1st. It's an awesome way for the senior high to reconnect after the summer and prepare for the next school year. Anyone going into grade 9 through grade 12 can attend. For all the info and how to sign up, go to oxfordbaptist.ca. This announcement is for everyone who is new to Oxford. We want to invite you to a newcomer's dessert night here at The Rock on August 14th, 6:30 p.m. If you're unsure if you're new, you probably are. Or if you've been attending Oxford for a while and just haven't connected with anyone yet, feel free to come out as well. Please register in advance so that we can plan enough desserts. Again, sign up at oxfordbaptist.ca. Okay, great news for anyone wanting to get baptized. We are planning an outdoor baptism service on August 21st. And don't worry, the staff has assured me that the water will be the perfect temperature. If you're interested in taking the next steps of obedience, please reach out to one of our pastors, either Robin, Tyler, or Jason. As I'm sure you can tell by now, our website, oxfordbaptist.ca, is the place to go. If you need any more information, want to register, or would like the sermon notes. You can also find a calendar of upcoming events, prayer items, and how to take the next steps in your walk with Christ. All right, this week, our community life pastor, Jason Nuchterin, will be continuing our series in Acts. Let's begin our worship with prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for your goodness and grace, and most importantly, for Jesus. Thank you for the rain today, and for the Rock Church allowing us to worship here this evening. Psalms 118, verse 24 says, "This is the day the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." Father, I pray that whatever challenges we face today in our own lives and as a church family, that we would remember to rejoice and be glad in it. and to give you the praise you are worthy of. I pray that you would prepare our hearts and help us to put aside any distractions as we worship you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, thanks very much, Cam. Good evening, everyone. It seems odd to be saying good evening, but here we are. Did anyone else's day maybe not start off the way they anticipated, like I did? But the reality is, this is the Lord's Day. It's not Will's day, it's not your day, it's the Lord's day, and it's also a happy one. So would you stand with us as we sing Happy Day?
That you would take my place, that its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Think about all those things he's done for us.
And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing all that you've done for me. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you, team, for leading us in that. We're going to sing another song, but before we do that, we'll just pray again. Heavenly Father, as we sing that song, Amazing Grace, Unfailing Love, thank you for laying down your life for us. Thank you for allowing us into your presence. We come before you and we pray for anyone here today or joining us online who needs a healing touch, whether spiritually, mentally, or physically, and that you would put your hand on them. We also lift up in prayer Kaylee Cunningham and her family. Give the doctors your wisdom on how to move forward, and we ask for complete healing of this little girl. We also pray for relationships that are broken or suffering. We ask that you would restore them, that you would bring them closeness and communication, that you would bring closeness and communication back into their lives. We pray for those whose hearts have been hardened and pushed you away. Soften their hearts so that they may see your goodness. We also pray over our building campaign that we would not lose steam, that we would stay the course and trust that you are faithful and will provide. As we sing and as Pastor Jason comes to share your word, I pray your Holy Spirit would open our eyes and ears to your teaching. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand with us.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me. change to come. Knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. You're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. See you do it again. You made a way where there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. I've seen you move, you move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way. Still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness.
Well, thank you, team. That was great. Just like Will, it seems a little strange to say good evening, but good evening. My name's, somebody's awake, that's good. Thank you, Connie. My name's Jay Nugtrin, and I'm the newest member of the staff team here at Oxford Baptist Church. And to echo with what Cam was saying, it's just been great. We've been going here for about 15 years, and our family has felt really loved and welcomed. And even in this new position, a new role, I really feel supported. And I just want to thank you all for the kind words of encouragement that the church family has given to me and my family in this transition. Since I started on May 1st, we felt really loved and welcomed. I also want to say thank you to Robin and for the rest of the staff team. It's just fantastic to work alongside such godly people. We're truly blessed at this church to have people who really love the Lord and want to serve them together. And it's awesome to just be a part of that as a staff team. My wife Lindsay and I, we have three little boys. One of our favorite things to do is to go for walks on trails. There's lots of cool trails around our area. And a lot of times we'll be walking along, and I remember when the boys were really young, when they were toddlers, I'd see like a bird up in the tree, and I'd point to the bird and I'd say, look at the bird, look at that, it's incredible. And the boys, they would just look up, and sure enough, they'd look right at my finger. I'm trying to get them to pay attention to what I see in the tree, but they're fixated on the finger, right? I don't know if any of you have ever experienced that with little ones, but it's just like, No, I'm trying to get you to see something else. I want you to see that bird, but they're just fixated on the finger, and they might even imitate it. So I'll get down, and I'll be like, no, like, you see that bird up there? And try to line it up with their eyesight, and it's just like, it takes a long time for them, especially as little guys, to figure out that they have to draw an imaginary line and see that bird that I'm trying to point them to. Let's pray this morning before we dig into the Word. Dear Lord, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the wisdom and truth that we can only get from it. Open our ears to hear your voice. Soften our hearts to respond to your spirit. Remove any distractions this evening that may get in our way. In Jesus' name, amen. As many of you know, we've been working through the book of Acts as a church on Sunday mornings. This evening, we'll be digging into Acts chapter 8, verses 1 to 25. So if you would, turn with me in your Bible to Acts chapter 8, starting at verse 1. Or if you're using your phone, go on the app and Acts chapter 8, starting in verse 1. We're just going to take little sections at a time, and I'll explain it as we go. Acts chapter 8, starting in verse 1. And Saul approved of his execution. And there arose on that day a great persecution against the church in Jerusalem, and they were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Devout men buried Stephen and made great lamentation over him. But Saul was ravaging the church, and entering house after house, he dragged off men and women and committed them to prison. The church is under extreme persecution. As we heard last week from Brian, Stephen has just been stoned to death. People who were followers of the way, people who believed that Jesus was the true Messiah, are being dragged out of their homes and thrown into prison. Saul, it says here, approved of Stephen's execution at the start of verse 1. And that word approved or consented, depending on what translation you have, signifies that he consented with delight. He was pleased with the murder of Stephen. In fact, as we see clearly in verse 3, Saul of Tarsus is the one that's heading up this persecution of the church. He was even approving of the executions of the Christians. This is some serious persecution. Saul was ravaging the church like a wild animal that hunts down and ravages its prey. Here's what Saul, who later becomes known as Paul, says about this time in his life. These are his own words, Acts 26, 9 to 11. Paul says, I too was convinced that I ought to do all that was possible to oppose the name of Jesus of Nazareth. And that is just what I did in Jerusalem. On the authority of the chief priests, I put many of the Lord's people in prison. And when they were put to death, I cast my vote against them. Many a time I went from one synagogue to another to have them punished, and I tried to force them to blaspheme. I was so obsessed with persecuting them that I even hunted them down in foreign cities. So it says here, not only is he going home to home, but he's going to where they are gathering to worship, in the synagogues. Paul thought that he was being faithful to his God. He was trying to preserve his religious traditions. He saw Jesus and his followers as a real threat to that. So because of this great persecution against the church in Jerusalem, verse 1 says that they were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria. Just like Jesus had said, they were to be his witnesses, first in Jerusalem, and then in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. The exact same regions from Acts 1:8 are listed in the exact same order here in Acts chapter 8. This is no coincidence. Remember that Jesus said these words to his followers, his disciples, before his bodily ascension. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. But up to this point in the book of Acts, the church and all of the followers were staying in Jerusalem. The Holy Spirit had come upon them in a powerful way on the day of Pentecost. People were coming to Christ by the thousands. The blind were miraculously given sight, and the lame were able to walk. The church, those who trusted in Jesus, was growing very, very quickly. However, the church was still just in Jerusalem. They were supposed to be witnesses that branched out and spread and reached other groups of people in different areas and districts. Jesus said that they would be his witnesses to Judea and Samaria, and now they are scattered to those very regions. The good news about how Jesus died and rose again to pay the penalty for sin spread far and wide because of the martyrdom of Stephen. Something that seemed horrific and terrible, God actually used. It spread here to Samaria, as we read in Acts chapter 8, and in Acts chapter 11, it also talks about Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch, other places that it spread because specifically of the martyrdom of Stephen. Let's continue reading in verse 4. Acts chapter 8, verse 4. Now those who were scattered went about preaching the word. Philip went down to the city of Samaria and proclaimed to them the Christ. And the crowds with one accord paid attention to what was being said by Philip when they heard him and saw the signs that he did. For unclean spirits, crying out with a loud voice, came out of many who had them, and many who were paralyzed or lame were healed. So there was much joy in that city. So the believers who were scattered from Jerusalem didn't stop sharing what they had seen and heard. Even though they knew that they were beginning to ruffle some feathers and get in trouble and get persecuted, they kept preaching the word. They didn't scatter and cease. They scattered and shared. They didn't stop sharing the gospel when they were driven out of Jerusalem. The believers kept sharing about their faith in Jesus. They didn't run and hide when things got hard. They didn't complain and sulk to each other. They kept on preaching the word. They pointed those around them to God. Persecution actually brought about the expansion of the church. Sometimes God uses hard things to bring about his purposes. It says here, though, that the apostles stayed in Jerusalem. Perhaps the authorities left the apostles alone because the last time they threw them in prison, they couldn't keep them there. If you remember in Acts chapter 5, the apostles were arrested and thrown in jail, but in the middle of the night, the angel of the Lord came and walked them straight out the door. Incredible. So maybe that's why they were left alone in Jerusalem. Whatever the reason, the apostles stayed in Jerusalem and continued to minister there. But Philip, who was one of the seven, along with Stephen, who was chosen by the disciples in Acts chapter 6, verse 5, to distribute food to the Hellenistic widows, Philip goes down to a city in Samaria and proclaimed to them the Christ. After Christ's resurrection, the apostles were the main preachers of the gospel, as recorded in the book of Acts. The men who were physically with Jesus on earth shared about what they had seen and heard from Jesus himself. Peter speaks to the crowd on the day of Pentecost, and 3,000 believed. Acts chapter 2. Peter speaks to a crowd outside the temple after a lame man is healed, and about 5,000 believed. Peter spoke to Ananias and Sapphira after they lied about the money that they had kept back from God, and they died because of it. It mentions a few times how the apostles were performing signs and wonders. However, in Acts chapter 6, there seems to be a bit of a shift. Seven men who were picked to look after the distribution of food to the widows as we heard about a couple weeks ago. In Acts chapter 6, verse 8, it's the first mention of someone other than the apostles to perform miracles. Stephen was mentioned there, doing great wonders and signs among the people. And then in Acts chapter 7, as we heard about last week, Stephen spoke and preached before the high priest and the Sanhedrin before he was stoned to death. These seven men did a lot more than just hand out meals to the needy in the congregation. They were full of the Holy Spirit and sharing the gospel. Here, where we find ourselves in the narrative this evening, it's Philip preaching the word, preaching the good news to the Samaritans. It's interesting to me to see not only the multiplication of the church, but also the multiplication of the leaders. As the church grows, so too must the leaders of the church. In verses 6 and 7, it also says that Philip did many signs and wonders. Unclean spirits were being cast out, and people were being healed by him. Where it was just the apostles in the beginning doing the casting out of unclean spirits, now there were other leaders doing this as well. A healthy church is raising up leaders that go out and share the gospel. Now in verse 5, it talks about how Philip goes to Samaria and preaches and proclaims the Christ to them. This is very significant. The Samaritans were half Jews because their Jewish ancestors intermarried with Assyrians and other people groups. The Assyrians purposely married other people groups to dilute their cultures and religions. So the Jews saw the Samaritans as partially responsible for compromise and corruption to the worship of the true God, the God of Israel. The region of Samaria was located directly to the north of Jerusalem. So faithful Jews who actually traveled to Jerusalem for feasts and festivals, they would go all the way around. They'd either go to the east or to the west and go all the way around. They didn't even want to set foot in the region of Samaria. That's how terrible that they thought of them. They wanted to avoid it at all costs. They would add great distances and times, a few extra days sometimes to their journey, just so they didn't have to set foot in that region. There was some serious racial hatred between Jews, God's chosen people in the Old Testament, and the Samaritans. Tensions were so great between the two that there are recorded accounts of violent quarrels between them. Racism isn't a new modern problem that we have just today. It's been going on for centuries. In Luke 10, 25 to 37, Jesus told a parable, a story about the Good Samaritan. I'm sure that most of us are familiar with this story, but to the Jewish audience, those two words did not even belong together. Good Samaritan. That can't be. Jesus intentionally chose to tell the story with the Samaritan as the hero. One day, Jesus was asked how a person can inherit eternal life. Jesus responded by asking him what the law says. Jesus asks us questions sometimes when we want answers. So the man answered Jesus, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself." So then Jesus told the parable of the Good Samaritan to illustrate who your neighbor is. There's a priest and a Levite in the story, and they are the ones that walked on by and did not help the man who was beat up and robbed. They should have been the ones to show God's love, but they walked around the mugged man on the complete opposite side of the road. Of course, we know it was the Samaritan who ultimately did what was right and showed God's love and proved to be his neighbor. After telling this parable, Jesus asked the guy, "Who proved to be the neighbor to the man who was robbed and left for dead?" And the man who answered, he wouldn't even say the word Samaritan. He couldn't bring himself to say those words. He just replied, "The one who showed him mercy." That just goes to show you how much the Jews despised the Samaritan people. They wouldn't even say that it was the Samaritan who was his neighbor. Elsewhere, Jesus also goes to Samaria and spoke with the woman by the well in John chapter 4. And this crossed a bunch of lines for the Jews. First of all, you didn't speak to a Samaritan. Second of all, as a man, especially as a rabbi, you didn't speak to a woman that was your wife. She was coming in the middle of the day because she was so despised by her neighbors as well. So this is the lowest of the low. But Jesus knew that she was in need of God's love. Christ modeled his perfect self-sacrificial love for the people around him, no matter what they looked like. He loved everyone. The Samaritan woman was amazed by Jesus and ran back into her town and told people, "Come and see. "Come and see the man that told me all that I ever did. Could this be the Christ?" She pointed people around her to Christ. She couldn't help but share about her experience with Jesus. Now back to where we're reading in the story of the church. A few years has passed since Jesus was in Samaria. Perhaps a few of the people that met Jesus that day at the well were there, hearing Philip share how Jesus had died to pay the price for their sins and had risen from the dead. It says great crowds of people were paying attention to what Philip was saying. People were getting healed both physically and spiritually, and there was much joy in that city. I love that. There's much joy. The town was filled with joy because of what God was doing there. Let's continue on in verse 9. But there was a man named Simon who had previously practiced magic in the city and amazed the people of Samaria, saying that he himself was somebody great. They all paid attention to him, from the least to the greatest, saying, "This man is the power of God that is called great." And they paid attention to him because for a long time he had amazed them with his magic. But when they believed Philip, as he preached the good news about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Even Simon himself believed, and after being baptized, he continued with Philip, and seeing signs and great miracles performed, he was amazed. Simon, the sorcerer, believes in Jesus and is baptized. He practiced magic and told everyone that he was someone great. In fact, as we see in verses 10, people would say that he is the power of God that is called great. Now, this magic isn't sleight of hand or illusions like we know of today. This is the magic that Simon was involved in was a form of pagan, occult, demon, and Satan worship. This was some serious stuff. Because of the power that he could display, the people used to pay attention to Simon, but now they were paying attention to Philip because of the miracles that he performed in the name of Jesus. So it kind of makes sense that Simon was amazed by the great miracles or the works of power that Philip did. The people could see the difference between the magic of Simon and the true miracles that were performed by Philip. The error was exposed by the truth. The sham was made known by the genuine, the real deal. The Samaritans believed Philip as he preached the gospel, and men and women were baptized. Now, baptism is identifying with Christ. Baptism is the outward act that symbolizes the inward phenomenon of coming to and accepting Jesus Christ as real, as God incarnate, as the sacrificial means by which those who believe in him can be forever reconciled to God. The purpose of baptism is to give a visual testimony of our commitment to Christ. It's the first step of real discipleship. It's a picture of the death as you go into the water, burial, and resurrection to a new life that we experience through Jesus Christ. And it's how we identify with him. It symbolizes the forgiveness and cleansing of our souls through our faith in Jesus Christ. So the people believed and then they were baptized. That's the pattern that continues over and over in the book of Acts. Now think about this for a minute. Word had probably spread to Samaria about the persecution that was happening in Jerusalem. It wouldn't be an easy thing for people to believe and be publicly baptized. That's really ratcheting up the commitment level. When Philip shows up preaching about Jesus, demonstrating the Holy Spirit's presence, the people knew what the cost would be to believe, and the cost would be high. They chose to identify and believe in Christ, even though it meant that they would be persecuted too. The difference between the magic and the real miracles was obvious to the people, and also to Simon himself. It says that he himself believed and was baptized. He then continues with Philip to learn from him and maybe to try to see how he does these miracles. It says that he was amazed by the signs and great miracles. The word amazed shows up a few times here. In verses 9 and 11, talks about how Simon amazed all the people with his magic and his sorcery. And then again, it shows up in verse 13, where Simon was amazed by the signs and miracles that Philip performed in the Lord's power. Simon was amazed. Let's continue on. Acts chapter 8, verse 14. Now when the apostles at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent to them Peter and John, who came down and prayed for them, that they might receive the Holy Spirit, for he had not yet fallen on any of them, but they had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they laid their hands on them and they received the Holy Spirit. So the apostles back in Jerusalem hear the stories about how Samaritans are believing in Christ and coming to salvation, and their lives are transformed. So they decide to send Peter and John to Samaria because they hadn't yet received the Holy Spirit. To be honest with you, this was a difficult portion of Scripture for me, a little bit different. And I read through a bunch of the book of Acts, and I didn't see this happening anywhere else. This was a one-time occurrence. But it must have been obvious that something was missing with the Samaritan believers. They were without the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit was received by the Samaritans through the laying on of hands by Peter and John after they prayed for them. It doesn't say exactly what it looked like when the Spirit came upon the Samaritans. Perhaps they spoke in tongues, like at the day of Pentecost, or perhaps they displayed other gifts of the Spirit or received fruit of the Spirit. It doesn't specify exactly what it was, but it was obvious and it was displayed. This particular instance seems to be a one-time occurrence for a specific purpose. The receiving of the Holy Spirit from Peter and John here was significant for the unity of the church. If they hadn't gone and done this, it may have led to a split church. There could have been a church in Jerusalem, a church in Samaria, and then later a Gentile church, right? And they didn't want that. The Holy Spirit brings unity to believers in Jesus Christ. The racial divide that was there for centuries was erased by the uniting of the believers in Christ. The Holy Spirit is what unites God's people, His bride, the global church. The Holy Spirit wants unity in the church. Let's continue on here. Verse 18. Now when Simon saw that the Spirit was given through the laying on of the apostles' hands, he offered them money, saying, "Give me this power also, that anyone whom I lay my hands on may receive the Holy Spirit." But Peter said to him, "May your silver perish with you, because you thought you could obtain the gift of God with money. You neither have part nor lot in this matter, for your heart is not right before God. Repent, therefore, of this wickedness of yours, and pray to the Lord that, if possible, the intent of your heart may be forgiven you. For I see that you are in the gall of bitterness and in the bond of iniquity." And Simon answered, "Pray for me to the Lord that nothing of what you have said may come upon me." Now when they had testified and spoken the word of the Lord, they returned to Jerusalem, preaching the gospel to many villages of the Samaritans. So Simon could see that the Spirit was given from Peter and John laying on their hands of the people of Samaria. Simon saw what they were able to do, and he was amazed by it. Simon thought that it was a trick that he could learn, that he could obtain this for himself. That's a neat trick, he thought. I want to be able to do that too. How much money do I need to give you to get this ability? See, it was common for magicians in those days to go to another magician and ask them to show them a trick if they paid them enough money. Now, on reading this, you might be wondering, was Simon truly saved when he believed and got baptized? Early in the chapter, it says that Simon believed and was baptized. Simon claimed to believe in Jesus and he even was baptized publicly. True conversion is only found in real, genuine faith in Jesus Christ. Baptism doesn't save you. Claiming to believe doesn't save you. It's personal faith alone in Jesus Christ. Verse 21 strongly suggests to me that he didn't have that saving faith in Jesus. Peter said to him, you have neither part nor lot in this matter, for your heart is not right before God. See, perhaps he saw the real power of God being demonstrated through the signs and miracles, or works of power, as is another way to translate it. And he recognized that there is a power there. He saw the power, but he didn't see God. The object of his faith wasn't correct. His faith was in the power, not in Jesus himself. Perhaps he wanted to use Jesus to bring more attention to himself. This reminds me of a parable that Jesus told in Luke chapter 8. Luke chapter 8, verses 4 to 7. And when a great crowd was gathered and people from town after town came to Jesus, he said in a parable, "A sower went out to sow his seed. And as he sowed, Some fell along the path and was trampled underfoot, and the birds of the air devoured it. And some fell on the rock and was trampled underfoot. And some fell on the rock, and as it grew up, it withered away because it had no moisture. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up with it and choked it. And some fell onto good soil and grew and yielded 100-fold. As he said these things, he called out, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." If you're wondering what that means, his disciples had the same question. And in verse 11, Jesus goes on to explain to his disciples what it meant. Now this is the parable. The seed is the word of God. The ones along the path are those who have heard. Then the devil comes and takes away the word from their hearts so that they may not believe and be saved. And the ones on the rock are those who, when they hear the word, receive it with joy. But these have no root. They believe for a while, and in a time of testing, they fall away. And as for what fell among the thorns, they are those who hear, but as they go on their way, they are choked by the cares and riches and pleasures of this life, and their fruit does not mature. As for that in the good soil, they are those who, hearing the word, hold it fast in an honest and good heart and bear fruit with patience. It's pretty clear to me that Simon wouldn't be considered the good soil. He seems more likely to be the rocky soil or the thorny soil. See, he claimed to believe, but his love for fame and attention and power choked out the word of God that he had heard. He wasn't rooted and didn't last, or his faith was choked out by the cares and riches and pleasures of this world. Charles Spurgeon once said, "No man with genuine faith in Christ will lose it, for the faith with which God gives will live forever." So Simon's faith seems to not be genuine, true faith in Christ. He claimed to believe, I think, in order to get something in return. God knows exactly where his heart was. I think, just like my little boys, when I was trying to point out that bird, Simon saw the finger that was pointing people to God. He saw that God is real because of the word that they shared and the Holy Spirit that was evident in Philip and Peter and John. However, he didn't recognize that they were pointing people to God. He only focused on the finger, like my little toddlers. He couldn't see what the signs and wonders were actually pointing to. He saw the pointer, but he missed the point. He focused his gaze on that finger. Peter rebukes Simon for trying to buy the ability to give the Holy Spirit. He was pretty harsh with him, really, if you look at the words. Peter recognized the seriousness of the situation. He didn't downplay it as a misunderstanding. "Oh, Simon, I don't think you have it quite right. You need to be taught a little bit more." Like, yeah. He was very intentional, and he could see that his heart was not right before God. But even in speaking these harsh words to Simon, he doesn't give up on him. He doesn't say, "Simon, you fool, like, get out of here. You don't understand what you're talking about." He still says, he begs with him to repent. He urges Simon to repent, to change his life, to change his direction, to do a 180-degree spin and follow God. See, even in our sin, God gives us opportunity to repent, to change our ways. He doesn't give up on us. Now, I find Simon's response here to be pretty interesting. He asked Peter to pray for him. "You pray for me to the Lord." He doesn't take personal responsibility and repent for himself. He wants them to do it for him. The only person that can repent for your sins is you. You are responsible for your standing before God. I am responsible for my standing before God. It's not up to your mom and dad or your spouse. It's not up to your pastor or the leadership of the church. You are to repent and accept the free gift of salvation through Jesus. Only you can do that for yourself. We don't know for sure exactly what happened to Simon the magician. But from some early church writings, Simon Magus, or Simon the sorcerer, the man that we've been reading about here in Acts chapter 8, is said to be one of the leaders of Gnosticism, which is the first group to be deemed as heretics. See, Simon was focused on the miracles, not on the master, Jesus. He wanted the power of God, not the presence of God in his life. He was missing that attention that he once had when he performed his magic and his sorcery. He wanted the attention for himself. The attention that Philip got The attention that Philip received when he preached Jesus and the attention that Peter and John received when they laid their hands on the people to receive the Holy Spirit, Simon wanted that attention for himself. Greed pops up in a few times in the book of Acts, and in each instance, it's a terrible thing. Ananias and Sapphira, they have that greed that kept some of the money for themselves, and it cost them their life. Simon the magician didn't come to God in repentance, but he came to believe in God's power with the hope of obtaining that power for himself. So what about us today? Is our faith being spread to others around us, others not like us? Are you pointing others to Christ? Are there Samaritans in Woodstock, Oxford County, that need to be pointed to Jesus Christ? Is the Holy Spirit's presence obvious in your life? Are you growing in love, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, and self-control? Is there fruit of the Spirit in your life? Are you becoming more like Christ? How about your faith? Are you like Simon? Do you have faith only in the power of God? Or do you have the saving faith in Jesus to forgive you from your sins? Is your faith in God or the things that are intended to point you to God? There's a song by Natalie Grant called More Than Anything, and these are some of the lyrics. Help me want the healer more than the healing. Help me want the Savior more than the saving. Help me want the giver more than the giving. Oh, help me want you, Jesus, more than anything. See, sometimes we want the signs and the miracles and the wonders and the gifts more than we want God himself. We can want the healing that we need in our lives more than we want the healer himself. We can want the saving more than the Savior, or the gift more than the giver. Even his blessings can be distractions for us if we allow them to get in the way of us seeing and worshiping the Lord. God might use a preacher, a church, or a singer, a sermon or a song or something else to speak to our souls, and we can respond to God and be so grateful, and that's a great thing. But if we put that person or thing on a pedestal in our minds and opinions, we can be forgetting that it's God that they are pointing us to. It can become an idol in our life. Don't lose sight of whom you were pointed to by looking only at that finger. Check your heart today. Are you loving and worshiping the Lord only, or are you focusing on the wrong thing? Even if it's something good, a great thing, it doesn't matter. If it's not God, it's not the right thing. Are you simply amazed at what God has done, or have you made it your own personal faith in Jesus Christ that is saving you? Where is your faith? Are you focusing on the finger, or are you seeing, loving, and having faith in the Father? Is your faith in the finger or in the Father? Let's pray. Lord, thank you for your word. Allow us to see you, Lord, and not focus on the things or the people that point us to you. Help us to see the fingers that point us to you and recognize that they are merely directing our hearts and our affections to you. You need to be the object of our love, that we would have faith in you and you alone. Use us to point others to your Son, Jesus Christ. Help us to want you, Jesus, more than anything. Amen.
Thanks very much, Jason. As I was preparing songs for the service today, it occurred to me with the persecution and the scattering of the church, and ultimately, looking through Acts here, it was really a bunch of people having uncertainty and lack of trust in each other. And so then, of course, that begged the question for me, because now I got thinking about promises. God has made a lot of promises, but how many? So I went back, and Google's an amazing thing. So found a couple of sources to show this through, but a gentleman by the name of Everett Storms actually was a school teacher out of Kitchener, Ontario, believe it or not. About 65 years ago, he went back through the Bible for the 27th time. He'd read it cover to cover 26 times before that. Went back the 27th time, and it took him about a year and a half, but he drew out approximately 9,000 promises that God had ultimately made, 7,500 of which were from God to humankind. So I thought that was pretty amazing. So one of my favorite promises, and I think it fits with what Jason has spoken to, reading from John 16, verse 33. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. Would you stand with us as we sing Standing on the Promises?
Thank you again, team, for leading us. I know God loves to hear voices, but I think he really loves to hear us clapping too, and that just sounds amazing. Thank you, Jay, also for just sharing what God has placed on your heart today. As we conclude the service, I want to leave you with a challenge. If we want to grow God's church and be a part of growing his kingdom, we need to show his love. As followers of Jesus, we should be the kind of neighbor everybody would want. So my challenge to you is this. Go out of your way this week to do something kind for a neighbor. Maybe it's cutting their grass, making them muffins, sending them a card or flowers. I don't know what that looks like for you, but maybe just let them know how much you appreciate them as a neighbor. Now, I will not follow through to see if you've done this challenge, but God will. So I'll leave that up to you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you again for your grace, and thank you for being patient with us. But I pray that we would not use your patience as an excuse to putting off our relationship with you. If there is anyone here or watching online that isn't sure where they stand with you, I pray that they would come to know you today as their Lord and Savior. As we go about our week, help us to be a good example of who you are to our family, to our friends, and to our neighbors. In Jesus' name, amen.